God's a good God. The devil is a liar.
Of Christ's victory. Now, it's not
We don't seem to be a trophy for God. Now, He loved, and we'll be separate, okay, of God's love towards us. Now, God wants to establish us to become His trophy. When you get a trophy, you win something, you don't put it into the closet and hide it. And we like to advertise, we like to put it up on the shelf and advertise it right away when it comes in and you've got a story to say. I really believe that that's the way God is with us. The thing is that He likes to put us there in display before all of humanity, especially the devil. When you go and he says, see, you meant bad for this individual, but I had a purpose for the life, and so look, I'm going to show them off in front of you. That which you thought was never going to happen in your life, it is happening. It is happening. Because that person is moving by faith out, coming, walking out of their bondages. See, so the only way you can come out of any kind of addiction, you got to walk out of it. You got to decide to walk out of it. But you can't walk out of it until you find out what direction that you want to go. That's not the solution. The gospel is the solution. Jesus is the solution. Jesus is the one that restores our identity, gives us our identity back. And our identity is sons and daughters of the Most High God. And everything that God, the Bible says that in Jesus' word, that He blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. There's no good thing for those that will walk upright before Him. No good thing that God will withhold. God will not withhold no good thing from us. From those that will walk, they choose to walk uprightly before God. God has given us a standard that we are to walk, and that is the standard of righteousness. As we walk in righteousness, we have been justified. Praise the Lord. We walk in our justification. All my sins, all my guilt, all my condemnation has been canceled. It's been canceled. And then we go and we sing praises to the Lord, and we stumble singing praises. What do you mean? Don't you got something to praise God about? When all your sins, all your debt has been canceled? If you were in debt, $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 in debt, somebody comes knocking at the door and says, here, your debt is totally canceled. I paid it off. We got to go, oh, okay, well, thank you. And you're going to sit back and just go on with life? What are you going to do? I mean, you're going to be so excited. You're going to thank that person. And I mean, it's like, well, what can I do for you? I mean, you'll be dancing and you'll be shouting. But yet that's what God has done in our lives. He shows us all. We need to show Him all of the goodness of God to show how good God is. We have to be a fragrance. We have to be sweet-smelling fragrance in the nostrils of other people, amongst other people. We need to smell good. Not talking about cologne and all that. No, we need to smell good in the spirit by having a heart of gratitude and looking at what God has done in my life and what He continues to do, because He ain't done with us yet. If we're all bummed out, we're all, disappointed in life, negative, everything, every time something happens to us, we just get discouraged, and we allow our environment to dictate our moods, and how we feel, and how we think, and all that stuff, then that is not a testimony of what God has done. We're supposed to be the trophies of His victory. And when we walk around this meeting, we're not talking, we're not walking. our worthy cause of what God has delivered us from. We are to walk in the victory, even if we don't feel like it. That's what's called overcoming faith. Using your faith to overcome, because this is the victory that overcomes the world. Everything and every situation that arises in this world, this is the victory. The victory, I get it and I attain it by faith. I don't feel victorious. I mean, how many of you got up in the morning and don't feel like you're saved? Guess what? You can't go by that. You got to realize that I am saved. And if I think about my salvation, then I guess if I'm discouraged, if I'm moody or something, it'll get me out of the mood. It'll pull me out of discouragement. Because faith is a victory to overcome any situation in life. Praise the Lord. God will become a trophy. Now God just loves to show us off. You know, the Bible says in the back of the last chapter, or the third chapter, he goes, that he sings over us with joy. That's God. And we have a hard time singing before God. We have a hard time praising God, worshiping God, dancing before the Lord. We have a hard time for that. But yet God dances. See, praise is an outward expression of what's going on inside. And that is it. If you don't feel like changing, you know what's going on inside. You give yourself away. Which is not a testimony of the victory of Jesus. When Jesus died on the cross, so I can be disappointed in life and be discouraged in life and be depressed in life, is that the whole reason why Jesus died on the cross? So I can go on spiritually. Oh, okay, thank you, Father, for salvation. Okay, and then go on still be discouraged in life and depressed? I mean, is that what Jesus died for? I mean, he won the victory? Okay, for us to obtain victory? And it says that now I call you more than conquerors? And then we walk around depressed? That is an insult to the cross. And the one who was hung on that cross, that's an insult to him. We get upset with one another. We get angry. We want to go off on people. And is that what Jesus died for? Well, I'm going to hold this against them, and they did this to me, and they did that to me. Oh, is that what Jesus died for? Because when you hold people in hostage, even if they're not aware of why you're holding them in hostage, you know what? It goes back not for them, but for you. Boy, it's quiet in here. Try helping you, ladies. So when it goes back to you, you get the poison. Pretty soon you look at the outlook of life, and your perception of life is all distorted. Because somebody hurt you, now you're living for somebody else to hurt you, and it looks like they're hurting you, so then you close them off, and then you close somebody else off, and you're going to jump from one relationship to another relationship, and all you're going to have is a whole bunch of failed relationships. It's because you're holding on to something you ought not to hold on to. When Jesus turned loose of our sins, he turned loose of our past. We offended Jesus. We offended him. We hurt Jesus. And yet he goes, forgive them, Father. And then we go and we hold somebody else and say, well, I'm going to forgive them. Wait, really? Not bad for them. Bad for you. Bad for you. All you're going to have is one poison going through, emotional. It starts affecting you emotionally. And pretty soon you just move convicted by your environment. And now you go right back to slavery again. And then when people look at you, when you say, I'm a Christian, they look at, wow, see a Christian? Wow, really? See, you shouldn't have to really say that you're a Christian if you already see them. Tis by your walk. Tis by your talk. Tis by the choices that you make in life. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, how many here have made bad choices in your life? That's all of us. How many continue to make bad choices? How many know that the bad choices can become lessons as you go on and live with your life? So the reason why, what we have to do is if we make bad choices, don't blame anybody else. Take responsibility and find out, why do I tend to make bad choices in my life? You get a person who's been married 5 times, but I don't know how many times they've done it before. Anybody know how many times they've been married? 12, 7 times, the next day you get married in a relationship. First of all, single master relationship. The master of affection, in the relationship. And then you consult her about the relationship. She's all over the line. That is no question. And the thing is that there's a pros and cons of the failed relationship. They all put it on something else. Oh, so-and-so is the way they did this, they did this, they did this, they did this, they know. But see, there's something inside of you that can't get over. And here's the sign, is that after all those relationships, you become very super, super sensitive. And you notice yourself, you get hurt easily. People can say some things. You mean, those that get hurt easily, don't know what they'll say. Well, if they don't talk that way, I won't get hurt. Yeah. Why don't you check yourself and find out why you get hurt? There's a big chance there's hurt that you have not come to accept. That you carried over, and this is what happens in a lot of relationships, that you carried over in the relationship, that you have not over it. Because every relationship that you get into, you become damaged. Now, I'm talking this way because I see a lot of new generation, a lot. And for every relationship you get into, you get damaged. And another one, and you can leave that one damaged. Another one damaged. Another one damaged. And you're always looking for somebody that can fix it. That's why you go to another relationship. To something to help fix it or ease the pain or ease the loneliness. Really? Wow. You're going to find out that person that you picked up, they always could put the person where your desperate moment. And people can, you know, be good and be nice and respectful. But after you live with them for a while, ugly comes out. And everybody has ugly because they have a doubt that they can take somebody up for iron sharp iron. And pretty soon, you start experiencing conflict in the relationship because they're not all what you thought that they were. You don't know somebody until you actually live with them. And then you go through the trials of life. See how long that lasts. If you don't have God in there, maybe don't last long. I really truly believe that my wife and I could never last in this long for the worship of Jesus. And really. Okay. We are so different. Amen. We are so different. We are brown and white outside. Two different cultures come from, two different ideas. Two different ways of doing things. You know, it's not, you know, people today doing, oh, it's chemistry. You know, don't forget the chemistry. We still got old man. You know, the old man that hasn't died off yet because of the choices he made. And so you come over with a whole lot of adaptations of wherever you came from. And then all of a sudden, when you go and you take out all the luggage out after you get married and stuff, you take out all the luggage out and you open it all up, you come to find out that, oh man, I didn't want to have back to the luggage. Wow! You got extra baggage. Man, now I got to deal with my stuff. You realize what I got? I got to deal with your stuff. And see, you can't just walk away. But that's what a lot of people do. And go irreconcilable differences. I can't get along with so and so. Well, that's an easy way out. just to walk away. That's an easy way. But guess what? You never change. Because you're trying to find the ideal person. But without changing. And what's going to happen? You're going to find the ideal person after the honeymoon's over with. You're going to find out that that wasn't the ideal person. When the honeymoon's over with. Can I help you? You know what? I can say these things. I can counsel people. And you know, people still do what they want to do. But it's not that God I can take. I just wait until it happens. And when it happens and we get consequences and stuff, because it will be. Then what I do is I go and I just wait for it and come to the surface. Why not? I'm there to help. I tell you, I think I'm going to save myself. So I'm not going to push them aside because they can continue to make mistakes. You know what? With God, you can do it over and over and over until you get it right. That's why God is patient and God wants us to operate at the same time. God is long suffering, but God wants us to operate at the same time. And who do we have the right to go and say, well, I cut them off, I tried to do the best I can, I just cut them off. Thank God he didn't cut us off. He didn't cut you off. And he's not getting it. How long did it take? It takes something to take longer than others. Depends how stubborn you are. But thank God, God's good at breaking down stubbornness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know why I went there, but it's overcoming faith works in believers who choose to live a life of full surrender to the Word of God. That's the only way it works. That's why people turn over to Romans chapter 12. This is the reason why people, Christians, will look at things. And they see, well, certain people can overcome, certain ones can't. That's just the way it falls. That means that we're describing God as it. God, sometimes you can make it happen for others, for one, but you can't make it happen for me. You know, the enemy will always put that in your head. Ask for so-and-so. Oh, God bless. Ask for so-and-so. You know, you're not going to get what they got. If they're living overcoming lives, well, you know what? That's because of them. You know, people say, well, you're living an overcoming life because you're a pastor. No. I'm a Christian. I'm living an overcoming life because I'm a Christian, not because I'm a pastor. The pastor is an office that I operate under in the body of Christ. But when I go home, well, I'll stay here, I'm still a Christian. But when I go home, I have to live out my Christian life at home by faith. And I have to fight the same devil as you fight. And the same type of circumstances that come against you that you have to come and fight and resist. Same thing. Okay? The thing is that I'm using the faith that God has given to me to operate in, and I'm doing something with that faith. And as a result, God gives me more. God will give you more also. But the purpose of that, God gives us more faith for the reason of overcoming. Overcoming. Now, in order to overcome, you have to have an obstacle. Don't you? You have to have something that goes against you. Now, we have to have the faith to be able to overcome it. In other words, I need to believe what God says that is mine already. I need to claim what is mine. See, God already gave it to me. He already gave it to you. What the thing is, you don't know what God gave you until you read the Bible. You don't know. What you need to do is read the Bible to see what God gave you, and if you're not experiencing it, then go after it and claim what's yours. That's the new operating faith. That's where faith is necessary. Amen. Romans 12, 1, 6. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body as your life. As you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you, is our reasonable service. Okay, now, if it says there, that which is acceptable, notice mercy. I beseech you. What does that word beseech mean? Huh? God, thank you. I urge you, stop and look in view of the mercies of God. God's mercy has been given to you and I. What are you going to do with the mercies of God? Huh? What are you going to do with the mercies of God? This is what God wants us to do. He's already laid it out. This is what God wants us to do. In view of the mercies of God, because Calvary gave it to us. Calvary released it to us. The cross released it to us. The death of Jesus released the mercy of God so we can have a revelation of that mercy. Mercy was operating in the Old Testament, but they couldn't understand that. That's why they blamed God for bad stuff. No, God's a good God, and so in view of the mercies of God, you know what? I owe my life to my Savior. And the one who is merciful, who didn't deserve mercy. That's what mercy is giving. Mercy is a person doesn't deserve it. But it is given. And guess what? It is given to us freely. But nothing is free. Somebody paid for it first. Who? Jesus paid for it. He says, now, let me worship you. What does God say to us too, with one another? What does God say? As you have been given mercy, you give away your mercy. Give away. You know, mercy that comes to our head often as humans? You don't deserve it. Ooh. Glad you said that. If you care, you don't deserve it. But mercy is given to the undeserved. See, this helps us, so poison doesn't go in us. This helps us in regard to our heart so we don't go fall prey to the enemy who's waiting for us to hold some grudges against other people. And if we do that, then he has what? The devil has permission. I don't care if you're a Christian. I don't care if you're a Christian. That you give the devil access and have permission the moment you hold grudges against other people. Because that's what he operates on. God doesn't operate that way. He operates that way. And so now what happens? Now we are up for grabs. The enemy will make hell. Hallelujah. Hello. God has given us His Word that is able to guard our hearts so we don't go there from the enemy. Now, in view of the mercies, what I'm going to do is, you have to choose it. I have to choose it myself, but you have to choose it. I have to give my whole life. I have to give everything to Him. Now, what is that? What does that look like? I can give everything to Him. Why? If you go on, verse 2, it says, I got to renew my mind. Because my old thinking is about me. My old thinking is about being selfish. You know, if I don't look out for myself, nobody else will. You know, I'm selfish. You know, I got to protect myself. I'm selfish. See, so we're wired in a certain way. But now, there is hope for us to be rewired in our lives. Now, the Bible says, now, you've got to commit your life in a transformation to take place. Otherwise, you're going to be conformed to the world where you come from. Now,
is that right? Conformed?
Yeah, conformed. Now, what God wants to do is that He wants to transform us. But He's got to change the way we think so we can make different decisions. But we need to educate ourselves with the knowledge of God's Word, and then don't try to reason that out, just obey it. See, we try to reason it out, say, I got to try to figure this out. No. Get your mind renewed with it, and just believe it. That's faith. That's faith. Don't consult your reasoning, it doesn't make sense. This person did this to me, and that person did that to me, and more likely than the other people are going to do bad things to me too. You don't get your mind renewed. Because then that's what's going to be attracted. You're going to attract that kind of negativity in your life. But you have to put the blame on everybody else for your results of your life. We need to sometimes look at ourselves and be honest with ourselves. And look in the mirror and look and say, you know, am I really giving my life to God? Am I really? You know for a fact, as I'm finishing the word, you know for a fact that you're really giving your life to God. You know. You know what? Others can catch it by inconsistencies. And the Bible says it is moreover, it is required that in stewards that a man be found faithful. So we allow the distractions of what's out there, we allow the distractions of life to get in the way. And we always put God in the hand of us. People do that, nobody's never worried. People do that because we give them their time to come. In the church world, why is it the same? God should have the same thing to be saved. In our church, they call it the summer slump. You heard that? Summer slump. The finances. The feeling of the church. Oh, does that mean you're going to be up for it at the end of summer? Oh! They're going to use the money that is supposed to be God's. Because we need to get time off. We need to have a vacation. So you're going to take it from God. What happens when you go and you borrow money from the bank? He's like, you need to get this vacation. You know, I'll figure that one out of your hands. They're going to come after you. But yet, we do that with God. We do that with God all the time. There should never be a summer slump. It should be consistent that that shows an unfaithful thing. Where is your love? Because where your heart is, there is where your strength is going to have. He is in it. Ouch. Okay. I'm trying to bring it up. I'm trying to bring this up. But I want to prove that any kind of condemnation. If you become patient, I'm not putting that on you. You probably put that on yourself. Okay. People will actually go out and pull back on you. Let's say they try to talk to you and go out and buy some stuff. You know, we have to have a family gathering. You know, we have to have a family thing. You know, it's a family thing. God wants a family. You know, you've got to justify. No, he just does. That's all. Just say, God left it. They try to justify it. Justify it. And it's good deal. And guess what? People like that that are inconsistent and not faithful are the ones that struggle the most financially. That's why, if you come up to pray, those that pray for the offering and stuff, I want you to make sure, don't go and say, bless those that cannot give. No. If you say, bless those that are not willing to give. Because the Bible is not even scriptural. We just in the Bible. God blesses those that give. Why do we turn that around? You know why we do that? I've heard it for years. If you don't want to do that, you're going to be nice to people that care. Oh, you're not being nice to me, but see, what you're doing is that you're not loving them. You're going to tell them the truth. Truth confronts. Love confronts. Amen.
This chapter 71. Every time I read chapter 1, it's part of that day.
it's not about the money. Friends, drugs, right? And says, come on, bring the person in with it together. Let's not get it all gathered together. Let's put our money together. Not the money together. And then you pay it off, pay off. Like that. It tells us the end result of that. Not giving. People aren't giving. See, this is what we're living, and this is what the Christian needs to wake up and not be part of it. But let me tell you, if you don't commit your life totally to Jesus Christ, if this is how you do it, then you know what? There's a good chance that the enemy still has your life. And you know what? You are in balance. Can you get a big deal with that? Can you live an overcoming life when you're in balance? No. One day you're on, one day you're off. One day you're excited, one day you're sad. Really? Those are signs right there. One day you're depressed, one day you're uplifted. Those are signs that you are in a balance. See, I'm helping you, right? You're looking funny. You're in a balance. I'm just helping you to be aware where you are at, that you don't have to stay there. That you can immediately get out of there, because the enemy will have fun over your life. He'll let you go to church. He'll let you go and get your word a bit. And then when you get too excited, then you got to go out there and get out there and test you out and make sure it doesn't take really hard. Because he knows the transforming power of the word of God, what it can do in your heart. And so he's got to go out there and take that seed out of there real quick. So he creates circumstances around you that almost looks like you feel like that the place comes up and you feel like you need to go to church. You know, because now you start acting up yourself. You know, because ugly's still there. And I think you need to get out. That just shows that you're in balance. Now, because people, religious people, let's say, nobody can live that way. I'm going to go, well, Lord God, why do you put it here in the Bible? If nobody can live that way, why do you put it there for? As a matter of fact, God, we can't do it. If it's just impossible, then you know what? God, you lied to me. And if you lied to me in that, what else did you lie to me on? You think you're going to serve that God and you're going to give your life and put it to Him? You're not. You're not. So what you got to do is that you got to know that let every man, the Bible says, let every man be a liar and God be true. Yes. So I don't care what other Christians say, that's not. Come on, you got to be real, but if nobody can live this way, I don't care what they say. I just believe what he says. And what he says that I can. And guess what? Because I believe that I can, I am. The thing is, I've got to feed myself so I stay there. Doesn't happen like, okay, all right, I'm an overcomer. I'm more than a conqueror. Oh, yeah. You know, tomorrow, the enemy's just going to go and work on your mind. Because you think you got it. Because when you think you got it, you think you got something else instead. You know what you got? Pride. That opens up the door for the enemy. Pride? Oh, I can vouch for that. I'm the father of pride. So, oh, you just let me in the door? Oh, okay. Let me feed you about that pride. Let me feed that pride. Let me get people around you that's just going to lift you up, build you up, build you up. You know, and then feel that pride up, and you're walking around all puffed up. The enemy knows what he's doing, but too many Christians are ignorant of his devices. Don't leave these doors just living life as just normal. Don't do it, because then the enemy has you. And you forget about what's being said here, then he's got you. He'll put something to replace it. Oh, that tells you it's too hard. I've had people say that to me. It's too hard. Love is hard. Love is strong. Love wants the best of people. Love wants to see the good of our top come. believe a lie. That's God. A person that lies, a person don't care. Don't care the outcome of their life. Because they're living their own life. No. This is about living our life before God. What do we got to do? Change the way we think. Change the way we think. I'm only going to give this much. No. Change the way you think. Give it all. Jesus did die and put away to Calvary on the cross. Guess how far he went? All the way. Gave his whole life. Oh. And then we come to serve him, and then he goes, and then we go and say, well, I'm going to give you part of it. It don't work. Because then who's got the other part? But you know what we say? We say, no, that's my part. No, that's not your part, that's the enemy's part. You think what you got is yours, huh? Amen. What do we got to do? Renew our minds. What does that say? We got to form the world that we transform by the renewing of the mind, that you may know that what? Perfect. The good, acceptable, and perfect will of God, right? Alright. People always look around. I ask them one of the major questions that Christians ask: what is God's will for my life? What is God's will for my life? I thought I'd show him too. He said, well, what is that? I don't know what God's will for my life is. The reason why you don't know what God's will for your life is because you're not thinking. Real simple. You don't have to know the whole Bible. Just live what you do know. And walk it out. And just the little that you know to walk out, you know that you're overcome. You'll realize this. That if I'm not being, my mind's not being renewed, and for transformation, and if we're not experiencing transformation, then you're experiencing conflict. You're going to be and you're going to realize this. Amen? This is the time. I'm going to talk to you about how Jesus, how Jesus set himself apart that we are to walk as disciples identically the way he did by setting himself apart to allow his word to transform our lives. And if you're not being transformed, you can come to church, you got to do it, and you miss something, whatever. And if your life is not being transformed, you're just being transformed. You've already conformed to what's out there. I've said this before, and there's a few, but for this years ago, that if you're not moving forward, you fall back. There is no place as a Christian to stand still. Because if you stand still, you're falling back. You're falling back. That means this: a Christian always moves forward because God promised prosperity to a Christian. Prosperity means push forward. So that means if you're not pushing forward, you're growing spiritually, you're falling back. And there are many, many Christians that are living in a backsliding state. And when you are in a backsliding state, what happens? Let's say this. When you have a cattle, or let's say, one of those kind of animals that a lion will go after, and you come to the way you learn how to do it, or a hunting animal, yeah. Now, what happens? What do you do when the warning is formed up? Slowly. Falling back from the rest and how we're supposed to move. Okay. You fall back, that's the same thing as the Christian. Supposed to move in the body of Christ. That move all together, that's why the Bible
What is Mark saying? He was trying to hold the who's it done? Satan walks around. The devil walks around. The light is going around. Seeking to be made by him. He's looking for you. He's looking for the people to go around to destroy you. Are you going to believe? Or are you going to give him up? It's a choice that you have to make. Are you going to get a hold of this word and just make it your life? Or are you just going to just hold on to the word and put it in union? That's called religion. Religion. Religion never sets people free. Religion doesn't heal people. Religion doesn't heal you in all the life. Religion doesn't heal you. It's having an ongoing relationship with Jesus Christ and loving him life to be renewed, to be rewired. So when you start thinking the way God thinks, I want to show you, I want to prove that to you scripturally. So in fact, I want to prove that in scripture to you how we can do that same thing. If we seek the purpose of God, then what comes out of our mouth will be justification. Justice, righteousness. You know what? Not seeking all the way, but seeking the way of heaven. See, I know it's wrong. When a person does something, you know, or acts a certain way or talks a certain way, I know it's wrong. I know it. Because I have a lot of wisdom in my heart. When I go over to the counseling session, I can tell. I know. The person is not, I can locate where they're on path based upon the truth. And why they're falling off based upon the truth. It's not judgment. It's the truth. It's judgment, not me. This is the delivery boy. The truth is judgment. And so when it doesn't align up to the truth, that second page is in my heart. And I've done it for 20 years. That second page is in my heart. This is why they're listening. They're why they're listening. And by the time they're done, they're why they're listening. This. And I say, okay, let's help you out. Let's help you out. And then you didn't know. You know, I'm pushing my hand. Okay, because I didn't know. So therefore, that keeps me humble. Because we approach people in a spirit of humility, not better than a spirit of humility. Knowing that I could have been me. I could have been me. But because of Jesus. Here we go, and we got it. Amen? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.